So we're going to start this with another of our hopefully viral audience polls. So if you can bring it up there. So the question is, will a terror attack inside the United States be live streamed on social media in the next year? So it's not just will there be a terrorist attack in the next year, but will it be live streamed? I was going to say we were hovering around 70-30, but we're making a pushback here. So let's go ahead and close it off there. You can see it's roughly about two-thirds of the audience thinks that it will be live streamed in the next year. All right, thanks. So I think it's important to pull back on all of this. This all started in 2004 when Mark Zuckerberg sat in his Harvard dorm room and started working, tinkering away on a software program to allow fellow Harvard undergraduates to vote on who was hot or not, what was called FaceMash, the origin of Facebook. It had little to do with war other than maybe the war between the sexes. We then, 2 years later, saw Jack Dorsey launch Twitter, and it was similarly fun and games. His very first post, the very first post overall on Twitter, was, quote, just setting up my Twitter. And the subsequent tweet went on to explain the name for this new messaging site was taken from the Oxford English Dictionary for, quote, a short, inconsequential burst of information. Today, these spaces, these social networks, have become clearly more than just fun and games and more than just inconsequential. It's become the space to homes of images like this. So you just saw the flat version of it.
And know that we will be victorious and they will be the losers. And you will be the biggest losers if you're sitting at home and doing nothing.
That was first, the credit to that goes to Charlie Winter of KCL for posting that. That's at least where I came across it. But of course, it's not just these kind of calls to action. It's being woven into battlefield operations. So for example, we're right now fighting the second battle of Mosul in this conflict. The first battle of Mosul was kicked off with a hashtag. It was a military offensive that was announced in the open. It wasn't kept secret. It was announced in the open, launched just like a conference or a movie or a new video game. We're also seeing the weaving in of popular culture in lots of different ways. So Hamilton's popular now. Here's weaving it into why you should rise up. Important, though, this is not just a story of ISIS or the Middle East. Social media has become a critical part of the new story of crime. We can see it in everything from drug cartel operations to the Instagram accounts of hit women. It's also becoming part of state-link war, setting the stage for state-link war. This is negative articles circulated on social media in the years leading up to the Ukraine conflict to the descriptions of what happened when little green men popped up in Ukraine. They clearly had nothing to do with bad activities. They were just there to help find lost cats. We're weaving it again into battlefield operations. This, for example, was posted by Christopher Miller, a reporter in Kiev, of what Ukrainian soldiers are getting right before a recent Russian offensive, where they're getting messages specifically to them to saying, quote, you're nothing but meat for your commanders. Quote, your body will be found when the snow melts. And it's becoming a shaping force in US elections. A technology that was supposed to bring us all together. Instead, we're seeing a split. So this is a image of essentially where people were getting their news on social media. And you can see there's two very different clusters between Democrats and Republicans. We're living in two different worlds, or arguably maybe two different realities. And maybe it's not just shaping it there, but it's shaping it in terms of foreign operations, to go back to the state link side, where we saw the US intelligence community connected to the topic of yesterday's conference on cybersecurity, where a hacking operation was then linked to an influence operation. So this is a space that goes beyond just ISIS. It wraps through war and politics. And we've got a great panel to help us figure out what's going on and what do we do about it. And essentially, I'm going to pose the same question to all of them. The first question is, what do you see as the biggest challenge in this space when the technology of social media comes crashing together with war, politics, and beyond? And first I'm gonna turn to Brad Allenby. He's a co-director of the Weaponized Narrative Initiative of New America and ASU's Center on the Future of War. And I'd steer you to, they have a report out right fresh off the presses.
Yes.
So maybe you can give us sort of set the scene for that.
So in looking at the most important problem that faces the Americans, I think you look first in the short term, and it's Russia. And it's Russia because what Russia has managed to do is to get inside the American OODA loop. The OODA loop is a concept created by a strategist called John Boyd: observe, orient, decide, and act. And essentially, if you can do that faster than your competition, you can destabilize their assumptions, their behavior, and their institutions. Russia has done that. That's essentially what has happened. So they've gotten inside our OODA loop. The traditional response is you try to tighten up the way that you respond. For a number of reasons, the United States will be unable to do that. We have to assume that going forward, the Russians will be able to get inside our operating loop and do it faster and better than we can. Now, we do have, I think, some unconventional responses, but we have not yet utilized them to the extent we should. But that's short term, because Russia is a weak state and it needs to be managed. But that's not really, I think, the long-term challenge. The long-term challenge comes from the fact, and this goes back very, very basic, that humans, communities, institutions, and our societies are, among many other things, information processing mechanisms. Over the past two or three decades, we've significantly challenged them with the amount, the volume, the velocity, and the variety of information that we've provided, to the extent that we have destabilized the institutions that we rely on, and for a lot of people, their sense of identity. What this means, I think, is that we're looking at an entirely different game when we talk about war and conflict. For example, this election, we all know that there were WikiLeaks that were used against Ms. Clinton. What happens if 4 years from now, every time a politician gets up to make a speech, their image replicated perfectly, their voice replicated perfectly, the background, all of the necessary information replicated perfectly in 50 or 60 different versions is spread by Cambridge Analytics to targeted submarkets? What's real? How do you ever find out what's real? And the answer is you won't. And my question to you is, how are you going to function in that kind of society? Because it's not science fiction. It's here. We can do this now. We just don't do it en masse. And the Russians, among many others, have an incentive to use this. So what I think we're looking at most profoundly, our most serious challenge, is in a period of very rapid change, we've lost our optimism, and we've lost our imagination. And unless we get both of those back, I think we're in trouble.
So next we're going to hear from Yasmin Green, who comes from the land of optimism and imagination.
That's true, actually. As you were saying that, I was like, yeah, good, I'm up next.
Director of Research and Development at Jigsaw, which is essentially the place within Google Alphabet that brings together public policy, research, and vision in terms of sort of the civil society implication of things. So what do you see as the biggest challenge in this space?
Thanks, Peter, and thanks, Brad. I should probably say that, you know, clarify that my optimism comes not just from my DNA, but actually because our goal at Jigsaw is to understand evolving threats, but then to build technology to mitigate against them. So that's a fairly like motivating, positive narrative. I'd start by saying that, you know, when we look at digital insurgencies, which is what I think we're talking about here with regard to state-sponsored information warfare, we're seeing a lot of benefits versus physical insurgencies in terms of far reduced cost, much less risky actions, actions that states can take against other states or their own populations that are unlikely to trigger public outcries because they're stealthy, and because attribution is so difficult in this space, they're unlikely to trigger retaliation. So we will see much more of state-sponsored social media manipulation. What we've heard discussed over the last year in the context of the US presidential election are a few things. Fake news, publishing classified information that has been leaked, and the stealing of, phishing and hacking and stealing of emails, which I think is one half of this challenge. And I think the public discourse has missed a really important part of this, because even if you fabricate a story or you get a hold of an incriminating email, it really doesn't do much to further your aims if no one finds out about it. And the part that's missing from the public discourse has been dissemination networks. And that's really key to like weaponizing or deploying any of the intelligence that you're gathering through any of these other means. And the way that this is working, as we're beginning to see, is through a seed and fertilizer strategy, which is state-controlled social media personas that are well distributed in social networks, different social media conversations, that plant conversations with narratives and with supporting evidence, whether they're from a real news outlet or from a fake news outlet, from leaks. And then those go on to have their own life as popular movements. And there are several reasons why a digital army of this kind is really valuable to a state. In pursuit of domestic and foreign policy goals. One of the use cases which we've seen actually popular across Mexico, China, Russia, Ecuador, Venezuela, really globally, is for censorship and targeting dissenting voices domestically, be it journalists or opposition figures. And we've collected case studies from many of these countries. A lot of them are in Turkey, where you see some of the hashtags going after journalists, starting with, the mayor of Ankara or, Erdogan's chief of staff, if you trace back the first time. And we have reports from these individuals, and there's this woman, all online intimidation, as an aside, goes after women worst. It's just easier to assault and intimidate women. So there's this Turkish journalist who said she described an attack on her where she received a dozen rape threats a minute. So like they're not just bots that are programmed to harass, they're also sexually harassing bots as well, which is pretty innovative in a perverse way. And then thinking about foreign policy goals, of course, it's not just to catalyze, a change of sentiment in a population abroad, but also potentially to change the way they act, perhaps the way they vote. And one thing for us to note is that while we may be accustomed to thinking of intelligence gathering in the context of being deployed in a military operation or to help with a diplomatic or trade negotiation, for other countries, subversion is the main goal. So there are some narratives that seem so outlandish that we think to ourselves, that was a fail for information operations, but actually the goal is to create noise and erode the underpinnings of a healthy democracy, which are some consensus around facts and history. I mentioned yesterday when we were talking that we have a Russian troll farm handbook, which is really interesting to behold because it's exactly what you would imagine that it would be. It's like a script for a call center, which is kind of what how these state-sponsored troll factories work. And it has the domestic and foreign policy goals Russia has. Undermining like opposition leaders, the killing of Nemtsov, for example, was suspected to be the work of the CIA. Some of the foreign, international goals like undermining NATO, that it's not working and it should be dismantled. And it's literally the headline, the talking points, and the links, the online links, be it news sites or, other supporting evidence for their claims. So we see evidence that this is happening. I think it's the beginning. I think we'll see a lot more. One of the things that I think is the biggest challenge here is this notion of useful idiots. which sounds really disparaging, but I'll follow up by saying that's all of us, which is people who are not the state-controlled assets, but they're the people who become mobilized and weaponized without having any idea.
So let's hear from Adam Sharp. Adam was former head of news, government and elections, at this platform for short, inconsequential information, which actually is quite consequential, Twitter.
News, government, and elections turned out to be a pretty consequential vertical to lead in the last several years, for sure. I think in terms of challenges, Brad used the words velocity a few times, speed a few times, and I think just the sheer volume of data, Twitter alone, 500 million tweets a day, and the speed at which that data moves tends to be the root of a tree of many, many challenges for many, many actors. That in the intelligence space and warfighting space that we're talking about today, you wind up with a balance of power really determined by who can get over the technical hurdle of finding the needle in the haystack, finding it most quickly, and turning it into something actionable while it's still relevant. Mm-hmm. This problem is not hugely different than the problem company customer service groups have in looking at social media, what individual users have trying to find the relevant news and updates from friends and family, or even what the platforms have, like Twitter and Facebook, in policing and enforcing our own policies on the platforms. Anytime you then try to solve for that by layering filters on top of that, you are, as Brad also noted, creating different realities, where the reality of what's happening on Facebook, what's happening on Twitter, what's happening in the world is defined by which algorithm, which curator, which filter you laid on top of it. I'd note that these, once you get past these technical hurdles, they also translate into policy challenges and others. You look at, I mentioned, for example, using Twitter and Facebook for intelligence gathering and the challenges to speed and actionability there. A lot of the obstacles are there for good reason. A lot of the obstacles and slowdowns are to protect constitutional freedoms of Americans at home and so on and so forth. But at the same time, the laws that are in place to govern this were all created before Mark Zuckerberg sat down in his dorm room. So on one side, you see abuse of this loophole through programs like PRISM and so on and so forth. And you see the companies stepping in to try to fill the void. Twitter, most clearly, creating policies in terms of protecting their user rights against government intervention and so on. That's a problem. When these platforms become the core fabric of communication on the planet, and it winds up pretty lawless governance of them, and the companies just fill the gap, you now wind up with this patchwork where your individual rights are not determined by what country you live in. They're determined by what app you're using, on what device, on which version of the terms of service didn't you read before you clicked OK. And so the volume and speed is the core root, and then from that, you see technical problems, policy problems, procedural problems across the board for all players.
Let's finally hear from AHMED YOUNIS, who is both part of this new fight and part of a new organization in this fight. He's Deputy Special Envoy and Deputy Coordinator of the Global Engagement Center at the Department of State. What do you see as the one prime challenge in this space?
Well, clearly we're talking about two different problem sets. I'll start with the first one, which is the non-state actor problem set. And the primary challenge that we see is that recruitment to terrorist organizations is a one-to-one communication reality. Whether that happens on the ground in real life or it happens online, most people who join terrorist organizations don't join them because they saw a plethora of tweets or they saw some sort of documentary. They join them because a human being that they know has communicated to them directly and convinced them that this is the best course of action for ameliorating whatever social ills that they're attempting to ameliorate. One-to-one communication, for the most part, as we see it moving online, is happening in encrypted space. And the challenge with encryption is that it renders the vast majority of people who can dissuade young people from joining terrorist organizations or engaging in terrorist activity that is inspired by the ideology of terrorist organizations, it limits their ability to do what it is that they need to do in their families, in their communities, in their groupings, in order to engage in that dissuading process. And so arise governments, us and other governments around the world, as really the primary players in penetrating that encrypted space. We are the people that have the tools to do so. And when governments get into the business of penetrating encrypted communication, they are by nature pushing against, and there was a reference to a number of countries here, the general stream of social development towards democratic realities. If governments are in the business of intercepting communication in encrypted one-to-one formats, they are, not us, but for the most part, engaging in an effort to persuade people to support some sort of political ideology. And so what you have is the people with the tools to deal with the problem are not the folks who can build the organic realities at the grassroots that render the use of violence as a means for social change ineffective. We see that one-to-one communication happening in the state actor model as well. Disinformation and propaganda by nation states is true. It is true that this is a communication that happens to many people from one source or from the troll farms, et cetera. But what we're beginning to see in our research is that very specific people in the online space are being targeted with very specific messages. And those individuals might be individuals who have great power, but they do not know that what they are reading is the propaganda and disinformation of a nation state attempting to sway their opinion or their analysis on an issue from one position to another. And because of the intimate nature, and these people are more expert than I am at this, because of the intimate nature of social media, one tends to assume or presume that this is an authentic communication from an authentic source that is not attempting to dissuade me through propaganda and disinformation. So this general trend of encryption and the general trend of one-to-one communication as a means of getting people to do something in the non-state actor mission, terrorist activity, in the state actor side of the house, believing that one state is more legitimate in its propaganda than the other, renders governments, our government and other governments, to be the primary players in the online space. And that, by its very nature, works against the building of the types of realities that need to come to fruition. Transparency of governments, democratic realities, social engagement, civic participation, an inclusion of women in the public space and in decision-making spheres, religious freedom for minority populations, the fundamental building blocks of societies where this type of activity is not needed as a means of ameliorating the negative realities that people are trying to change.
So this is a policy town, a policy conference. I want to hear from each of you one distinct policy that should be put into place to answer either the problem set you put forward or maybe the other ones out there. But what's one policy that can be enacted by a Congress, by an administration, and kind of keep it pithy if you could? So I'll go back to Brian.
One, if you're going to have Russia go asymmetric with disinformation campaigns, you need to go asymmetric. We should be—
If they go low, we go low.
Not, right. we go with our principles. We're a capitalist economy, so what we do is we go talk to the oil companies and we figure out what kind of tax break they'd need to knock 20% off the price of gas. And we tell Russia that that's exactly what we're gonna do unless they stop it. What did we do? We expelled 35 diplomats. They took it as a mark of pride. What do we do if we knock them with a 20% drop in the price of petroleum products? We hit them very hard. We've got to think asymmetric. Another example of asymmetric is we should be flooding the market with books that ridicule Mr. Putin. If you think about it, you know, he's running around bare-chested with motorcycle gangs that have joined the Russian Confederation primarily because the banditos were moving in on their turf. Now, if that's not a satirical novel, I don't know what is. He doesn't care if we tell people where his money is, but if you ridicule a person like that, what you do is you undercut his narrative and you do it badly. I haven't seen any of that. There's two.
I think that's a really good point about what there's no form of deterrence here because this is new. You know, like the motives are not new. I mean, hoaxes and politics and satire and information warfare have been around since the beginning of media. I think what's new are the tactics, and because of this challenge with attribution and the novelty, there isn't really a doctrine around around proportional response, and there is no deterrence. So I think that might be an area for focus for policymakers.
I think it's important to preface my answer here by reminding everyone my bio is former head of news and government at Twitter, so it's a personal opinion. I think just the investment from an appropriation standpoint, as well as a thoughtful standpoint in creating a policy framework, has been lagging in this regard. You know, the president's budget announced in the last week does dramatically expand funding for the military, but it is actually disproportionately focused on a more traditional war footing and not on these areas and figuring out how to maintain the US's edge in these information processing challenges. On the policymaking side, where things have been left ambiguous because work in this space has been conducted through laws 20 years old, the companies, for good reason, will fill that space with a bias towards protecting their users. And so if you do take the position that there are times when the government has a rightful legal path for needing to access certain information and access it quickly, you need to create that path and you need to create a legal framework based in the technical realities of today to get there. Because if you are basing it in the technical realities of the mid-1990s, as most of these laws are, then you're leaving it up to the companies that are going to take the most anti-government position and the most pro-user position, because when in doubt, respecting and defending the user's voice is the principal objective of the business.
It's hard. I mean, offensive counterintelligence and political warfare are things that we deal with all of the time. And we at the GEC are one of the few parts of government that have some carve out from the Privacy Act that allow us to do things with big data that other offices are not allowed to do. I guess, you know, the legal restrictions exist for a reason. We fight these wars with one hand tied behind our back, because other nation states don't have the legal regimes that require them to respect the individual and require them to respect the free flow of information. So I would say certainly there is room for public discourse around more freedom for US government agencies to engage in this kind of activity, provided that there is very serious and continuous civil rights type oversight over that activity. But you know, this is something that I deal with every single day. There is a point at which you reach diminishing returns. And that is when you are engaged in so much activity that resembles the enemy, that you no longer look like the country that you were before you began that type of activity. And then I don't know really who wins at that point in time.
Great point. I'd also toss out as a policy the need to recreate the Active Measures Working Group, which was the Cold War group. It was interagency between intelligence community, State Department, military, that identified Soviet lies that were being spread as rumors and information operations. We have a need for that today with the Russian version, but I would say involve the tech companies and civil society in it. In particular, it's not just about identifying it. It allows you to then debunk the activities of useful idiots, which is a Russian term, who deliberately spread those lies to their own political advantage in our system. So you can point to the origin of the false news that they're spreading and say, hey, this actually is coming from Russia, and it gives you a more official means to go after it. So let's open it up to the audience. We'd love to get your questions. Please wait for the mic to come to you. So just go ahead and raise your hand. None whatsoever. There we go, right over there.
Yes, good afternoon. Thank you very much for being here. My name is James Dickey with Janes. So in warfare, it's easier to destroy than it is to create. And so much of what you've all been discussing today is the ability of adversaries to destroy the truth or destroy the narratives that we try to create. Would you perhaps think that it might be that we should prioritize what we choose to protect in terms of narratives as a way of protecting our resources, the limited resources that we have available to us to fight these online battles with our various adversaries?
Yeah, absolutely. I think it becomes, in periods of rapid change, what you know is that most of what you think, and more importantly, the implicit assumptions underlying it, are going to be contingent in ways that they were not before. So one of the questions that we should all be asking ourselves is, if we have to give things up that we believe in, what do we give up? And to your point, what can we not give up because it means we give up too much of what it means to be an American? That's the kind of question that we need to be thinking about now, because we're beginning to do that at the edges, and we're certainly going to be challenged. One of the things that this country is, among many other things, is the primary enlightenment power. We believe in the individual. We believe that there is a truth and that it is accessible, and that the way you can find that is through science. What happens when that no longer is the belief of the public? Right. Which in many areas of the public, depending on the issue, it's not. Right. How do you respond? Right. More importantly, who responds? Anybody who listened to the talks this morning can have no doubt about American conventional superiority. It's important to realize that we have lost our overall superiority, not because somebody thinks they can challenge us conventionally, which I would be very surprised if they could, but because what they've done is they have gone radically asymmetric, and we have not responded, and we don't know how to respond.
A great illustration of that is, if we go to the Russian case example, world's 13th largest economy just cut its defense budget by 25%, but I would argue has made a much better investment in their influence operations. Let's get another. Anyone else want to weigh in on this question?
I was just going to weigh in because Brad raised the point, and going back to your earlier comment, I think that public discourse about those rights is essential because rights that nobody knows they have wind up being unactioned rights. And I think the challenge right now is that you do have this patchwork where there's some gaps over here that bad actors take advantage of, and areas over here that are made up by a patchwork of the companies trying to come to an answer. And that's where I think we do need to come to a solution. I tend to fall more to the pro-company civil rights side of the equation, but we can't just leave it as a jump ball and say, okay, it's done. We need to get to some point of resolution there.
It's a challenge. You know, Yasmin and I have been in a number of fora where this is discussed, and where we try to find a sweet spot where we can work together on those things we can work together on. Active measures is a challenge because active measures, there are a number of people that work for the GEC who are part of the active measures working group. And we have that problem set as well as the non-state actor problem set since the National Defense Authorization Act. The purpose of active measures was to expose, but exposure requires a level of literacy and a clarity of branding between the two teams that renders it valent in its ability to convince people that that disinformation that is being directed to you by that nation state is actually not in your interest. And I'm not sure that we're at that place in the world at the grassroots where people say, yeah, absolutely, the United States stands for And these other guys, they stand for something that opposes that. And so that the enhancement of literacy at the grassroots around the world, for them to understand what are the interests of nation states in engaging in the disinformation and propaganda that they engage in, is a necessary corollary to a product like the exposed mechanisms of the Active Measures Working Group to have any sort of efficacy in this conversation.
Let's get another question back there in the corner.
Hello, Matt Zace, I'm a US Army Cyber Command. Assuming that what we see on social media platforms has not been adulterated by nation states or non-nation states, that everything that we see is true, and assuming and understanding, like Mr. Singer said, that Russia information warfare is a core competency in Russia, but it's not in the United States, what concretely needs to change in the DoD, and what does that look like? And secondly, to what level does that responsibility rest upon companies in Silicon Valley?
So, Yasmin, we just saw your boss on stage. Speak to this cross between the Silicon Valley view, but you also interact a great deal with the military. So, how would you answer this?
Yeah, I think the way that Eric framed it was right. His role with the Pentagon is to share ideas and suggestions and help transfer whatever's working well in the tech sector to make Silicon Valley, the most innovative place on the planet. I have the same feeling about where our relationship with government should focus, and that is on us as the tech sector being able to understand the tactics that are enabling, the turbo boosting of information operations as we see today. Because again, the motives aren't real. What's, the internet is the game changer. And it's the mechanics that should be the focus for us, because things like ISIS recruitment online or Russian trolled armies online, none of that is good for business ultimately. The tech companies don't want that. They're not turning a blind eye to it intentionally or maliciously. They are trying to solve these problems, and it's our job. At Google, we say the mission is to make the world's information useful. And oh God, I don't know our own mission. It's been 11 years. basically, it's access to information, and it is a bit of a whack-a-mole question. A lot of the ways that we come up against an adversary with regards to organizing information is criminal networks. I go and speak to our security team at Google, and I'm talking about state-sponsored bots, and he's telling me about Viagra-sharing bots because that's the thing that he sees in volume and he can talk about. And there's definitely a similarity there. We're really good at thinking about commercial motivations and criminal motivations for doing malicious things online. We're a bit less good at looking at political motivations, but I think that's where we have to focus. And we're doing some work on this already in terms of being able to identify and detect and hopefully in the future disrupt dissemination propaganda networks.
One thing I would add is the training environments need to be updated. So for example, in the article we did for The Atlantic, we looked at Fort Polk, where it was the story of where the Army mechanized and tested in Louisiana maneuvers. What does it mean to move to tanks and trucks? Then during the Cold War, as where we trained for large-scale armored warfare. Then after Afghanistan and Iraq start, they change the training ground to be villages. A couple years later, they realize they need to populate the villages, not just with enemy forces, but with actors playing civilians, of tribal leaders, media, civil society. Now they've just started to update at Polk to put a simulated internet over it, where civilians are tweeting and recruiting and posting a video of their ambush. But Polk is an example of it. It's not universal across the system. So we've got time for one last quick question right here.
Thank you. My name is Nizar Farsakh. I'm a leadership consultant. My question, it seems all of you are talking that the situation we are in is one where we are not prepared, right? The tools we have are inadequate for where we are. It's kind of the nuclear age, where we were not prepared for this scientific tool, right? And we had to learn how to deal with it. My question to you, since all of the tools that we have are built on assumptions that are no longer valid. How far back do we need to go on, for example, the separation of powers, that we thought the government would respect the Constitution, but in fact it did betray the Constitution? So what are the things that we need to teach our children, or what do we need to change? What are basic fundamental things that we need to take a second look at, given the new environment we are in that we still don't understand?
Okay, quick one sentence answer. What would you change in our education system? And you can choose whatever level, from elementary all the way up to professional military education. So one thing that you would change.
Start on that end.
You're the Professor Dodge, come on.
So it's very clear that education is one of the institutions that is going to fail, and fail radically, at all levels, including universities.
One sentence change in curriculum.
I think that I would shift from trying to teach people how to function as individuals to teaching them how to function as part of integrated techno-human cognitive structures.
Gotcha. Yasmin.
Such a good sentence. I would say teach geopolitics in technology courses and teach technology in geopolitics courses.
Information evaluation and critical thinking, yeah, as a jumping off point to any number of paths from there, but it's not the typical multiple choice standardized test question.
That's right, a pedagogy of critique. Without critical pedagogy and the ability of a young person to engage in critical thinking at multiple levels, in the personal space as well as in the social space, we have no chance.
Teach how to source properly and the importance of sourcing properly, which then will help you in both social media warfare and the problem of plagiarism.
Yeah.
All right, so thank you very much for this great panel for joining us. Please join me in a round of applause.